Since the days when the early settlers first came to the Great Lakes region, a highly productive fishery has existed in these vast inland seas. Scattered in many small fleets around the shores, the fishermen of the Great Lakes built a multi-million dollar industry, shipping fine food fishes to the markets of the great cities. Trap netters, gill netters, pond netters, and hook and line fishermen, working mostly as small family units, annually produced millions of pounds of whitefish, walleyes, perch, chubs, herring, and many other species. Prized among the Great Lakes fishes as a delicacy is the lake trout. Noted by epicures for its fine flavor, it has always been in great demand. Primarily an industry of Lake Superior, Michigan, and Huron, the lake trout fishery once produced and shipped to market as much as 10 million pounds of fish annually. In recent years, however, a catastrophe has been visited upon these fisheries by the invasion of a voracious marine predator. Commercial catches diminished as this parasite multiplied in unbelievable numbers. And then, tragically and abruptly, the lake trout fisheries of Lakes Huron and Michigan collapsed completely as the fish all but disappeared from the fishermen's nets. The scarred victims of this dangerous predator pointed all too clearly to the cause, as did the presence of the parasite itself among the catches. Where did this invader, the sea lamprey, come from? And how far has he spread over the Great Lakes? The sea lamprey has always lived in the ocean and in Lake Ontario. Bypassing Niagara Falls through the man-made Welland Canal, they failed to establish themselves in Lake Erie. But after entering Lake Huron, they rapidly overran it and nearby Lake Michigan. Today, they have just begun to penetrate and establish themselves in Lake Superior. Economic losses have been severe. On Lakes Huron and Michigan, entire fleets have been tied up. Equipment and buildings have been abandoned to the elements. And to the fishermen, annual losses in cash income have amounted to $3.5 million. The sea lamprey is most easily seen and appears most vulnerable to destruction by man when it starts on its spawning migration. Mature sea lampreys average about 17 inches long. They do not feed once migration has begun. Nature has stopped their desire for food, and their stomachs and intestines shrivel to a mere thread. The female may carry as many as 100,000 eggs. The migration takes place in the spring, when the lamprey must leave the lakes and seek spawning grounds in streams. Traveling upstream, often for many miles, they work their way with the aid of their sucker-like mouths over many seemingly impassable barriers. Spawning grounds are common shallow water riffles in upper reaches of the river. Usually the male arrives first, selects a site, and begins construction of the nest. Soon the female arrives and assists in the work. Slowly the nest takes shape as they move more and more stones with their mouths. When the nest is about half built, the lampreys begin to spawn. The eggs lodge in the rim of the nest, where they are covered with sand and more stones by the lampreys. Nest building and spawning may take almost 3 days. Now blind and spent, they soon die, thus completing their life cycle. After hatching, the young lampreys, called larvae, burrow out of the nest and are swept helplessly to quiet waters where muddy bottoms provide their homes for 4 years. Diving to the bottom, they burrow quickly out of sight. Throughout the larval life, they are blind and harmless, feeding only on microscopic organisms. Growing slowly, they are about 6 inches long when they transform into young parasitic adults. Burrowing out of the mud, they start their journey downstream to the big lakes. The young lampreys move passively downstream, allowing themselves to be swept along by the current. Some leave the streams in the late fall, others during the winter, but most come down with the spring breakup. Now about as big as a lead pencil, their newly formed sucking mouth and large eyes are distinctive features. At last, when the young lampreys reach the lake, they are ready to begin their destructive attacks upon fish. During its adult life, the lamprey turns into a real vampire, feeding only on the blood and body juices of its victims. With the many sharp teeth in its sucking mouth, it rasps a hole in the fish's body. A secretion formed by the lamprey keeps the blood flowing freely from the wound. Delicate species like trout may be killed in 8 hours. More hardy fish like bullheads may survive several attacks. Apparently, some lampreys occasionally mistake each other for a good meal, the results being something like a wrestling match between two contortionists. Seeming not to care for the flavor of lamprey, they seldom do each other any harm. A fish is seldom able to free itself from a mouth like this. Fish that survive bear ugly wounds like these. Preying on many victims, the lamprey grows rapidly and in 18 months is ready to seek a stream and bring forth another generation. Scientists, seeking a means of suppressing the now vast populations of this destructive parasite, have studied every detail of its life history with the object of finding the most vulnerable point in its life where it could be successfully attacked by man. Studies show that the lamprey can be most easily controlled if destroyed when entering streams on their spawning migration, when moving downstream to the lake as young parasites, or while living as larvae in the stream beds. Although these points of attack appear the most promising, all possible methods of control are being explored. Natural enemies have been sought, but results have not been encouraging. Specific poisons for killing larvae have been discovered and appear promising as a control method. Mechanical devices have been developed which block or trap migrant lampreys. Weirs and traps such as these capture all lampreys entering a stream, preventing the spawning of another generation. These weirs offer an immediate method of attacking the sea lamprey. Unfortunately, installation and operation may be very expensive if all lampreys are to be destroyed and runs of game fish protected. Also useful are dams and inclined screen traps, which capture young lampreys migrating to the lakes. And barrier dams with curved lips, which block adults from the spawning grounds. The most practical method of control to date is electrical devices, replacing the grates of the mechanical weirs or the walls of the dams with an electrical field in the water they operate efficiently under all adverse conditions at a fraction of the cost of mechanical weirs. One type is this simple electrical barrier, which prevents migrants from reaching their spawning grounds. Operating at line power voltages, the power cost may be as little as 5 cents an hour. Another type is this electromechanical weir and trap, which is more useful than the simple barrier, and this is how it works. The charged field of the weir is strongest between the electrodes. A weak fringe of this electrical field extends some distance downstream from the weir. Most fishes swimming upstream feel these weak impulses and, attempting to avoid them, are deflected without harm to a trap for transfer upstream. Some lampreys may do this also, but being less sensitive to electricity, most penetrate the strongly charged field where they become paralyzed and die. These electromechanical weirs and traps also cost but a few cents an hour to operate. With the development of these relatively inexpensive methods of control through electricity, efficient and inexpensive means are at hand by which the numbers of sea lampreys in the Great Lakes may be reduced. A comprehensive program of suppression can be initiated on all of the lakes. This will be an economically sound investment in the restoration of a valuable food resource. With such a program in operation, we can look forward to the day when the fisheries of these lakes will be returned to their former productivity.
Sunrise on the Great Lakes signals the start of another day of fishing. From Eastern Lake Ontario to Western Lake Superior, anglers and commercial fishermen head out to test their skills.
Let me see here. There's one fine shine in one. That's about it.
The chase is centuries old, and for the economy of the U.S. and Canada combined, it means business. Between $2 and $4 billion of business a year. But the future of this valuable resource is in jeopardy. An invader swims below these clear blue waters, which in some areas takes more lake trout and salmon than sport and commercial fisheries combined.
Lamprey on them, and 8 out of 10 either have lamprey or scars. Virtually every fish we get has seen a lamprey, and it's tough, it's bad, very bad.
An estimated 620,000 adult sea lampreys live in the five Great Lakes, nearly 500,000 in Lake Huron alone. Sea lampreys belong to a family of jawless fishes that dates back almost 300 million years. That's even before the dinosaurs. Just one of these primitive animals kills between 10 and 40 pounds of fish, or roughly 20 to 80 times its body weight. And they do it by attaching their suction-type mouths to a fish and sucking the body fluids.
They have a tongue that flicks out, and on the end of this tongue are some raspy type of teeth that, when the tongue is flicked out, it's almost like sandpaper in that it etches away the scales first of the fish and then gets into the skin and then into the flesh of the fish.
Sea lampreys are native to the Atlantic Ocean, yet made their way as far inland as Lake Ontario. The powerful Niagara Falls served as a natural barrier to keep them out of the upper Great Lakes. But when the Welland Canal was constructed in 1829, then deepened in the early 1900s, it opened a new route, and the invasion began into the upper Great Lakes. It happened slowly, but by 1938, sea lampreys reached Lake Superior. The saltwater swimmer had totally adapted to the Great Lakes freshwater. with ideal spawning streams, no natural enemies, and a prime food supply of lake trout, burbot, and whitefish, the sea lamprey took over. Their soaring population, combined with other factors, devastated a once thriving commercial fishery. Lake trout production in Lake Michigan dropped from 7 million pounds in the 1940s to nearly nothing in the 1950s. With the future of the Great Lakes and the fishing industry at stake, representatives from the U.S. and Canada joined forces to stop the sea lamprey and bring back the fishery. In 1955, the Great Lakes Fishery Commission was established to plot a strategy. To this day, the commission contracts lamprey management to the Canadian Department of Fisheries and Oceans and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. This partnership operates through a network of field and research stations in such places as Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario, Hammond Bay, Ludington, and Marquette, Michigan, as well as La Crosse, Wisconsin.
Well, it has to be an international effort because fish don't recognize boundaries, and the fish that we're talking about, or the species we're talking about, the sea lamprey, has come into the Great Lakes through canals that have been built both by Canada and the United States, and have populated all of the Great Lakes, which is the largest freshwater lake system in the world, shared by two great countries.
Both federal governments, the province of Ontario and the eight Great Lakes states, along with tribal associations, share commitment and biological knowledge, making their work a model for successful interagency cooperation.
The international aspect of this program is very crucial to our success, especially now, because the program cannot function on a country-by-country basis. It has to function on a lake-by-lake basis, and even looking at all the lakes at once to make these decisions on allocation of resources. We have to have everyone working on Lake Huron sitting in one room working as one group.
The first step to control is understanding a lamprey's complex life cycle. They are classified as petromyzontidae, or stone suckers, which describes their nest-building technique.
They are a powerful animal. I've seen them move rocks that you don't think an animal like that could move, 4 or 5 inches sometimes. They just pick it right up in fast current, pick it up, swim with it a short distance, nudge it along, and put it right into a nice pile.
The female deposits up to 100,000 eggs in the crescent-shaped nest. After spawning, adults die, but field technicians excavating nests estimate as many as 6,000 fertilized eggs hatch in about 21 days. Larvae then drift downstream. Blind and harmless, they burrow into the soft sediments.
A larvae has a mouth that we call an oral hood, and larvae live in burrows in the stream bottom. They stick their head up out of the burrow, and they filter the water through this oral hood. They feed on different kinds of food, a lot of organic matter, some types of algae. They will grow in a stream from probably 3 to maybe as long as 12 years before reaching a length of about 120 millimeters or so.
The time it takes for this to happen depends on the stream's water quality, temperature, and food supply. But once the larvae reach about 5 inches, the filter feeding phase of their life ends, and a most amazing transformation occurs. They develop eyes, and the oral hood changes into a sucker-type mouth ringed with sharp teeth. Now they are ready to enter the lakes and spend the next 12 to 18 months feeding on fish. In this life cycle, sea lampreys pass through two vulnerable periods: the years when larvae live in soft stream bottoms, and the short period in the spring and early summer when adults return to the rivers to mate. Early control attempts focused on blocking and trapping these adults with electrical and mechanical weirs stretched near the mouths of key streams.
They block spawning runs of lampreys, and that's good, but they also block spawning runs of fish, other types of fish, and that's bad.
High water also made these earlier designs ineffective, and they were expensive to maintain. So emphasis switched to a chemical that would target larvae. And by the late 1950s, after testing over 6,000 compounds, 3-trifluoromethyl-4-nitrophenol, or TFM, was selected. Current TFM registration with the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency is maintained by the National Fishery Laboratory at La Crosse, Wisconsin. This information is also used by Agriculture Canada. In controlled diluted amounts, TFM kills lampreys, yet does not harm most healthy plants, insects, fish, and other animals. After extensive field testing, TFM treatments began in Lake Superior tributaries, where in 1961, a record 50,000 sea lampreys were captured in assessment traps. By the next year, the chemical treatment already showed obvious results. And in 3 years, TFM reduced the sea lamprey population by 84%.
If it wasn't for lamprey control, I don't think we'd see the fishery coming back like it is, certainly in Lake Superior, where we have naturally reproducing lake trout.
Similar successes occurred as the program expanded to Lakes Michigan, Huron, Ontario, and Erie. The best documented results are from Lake Erie, where wounds were as high as 60 out of 100 lake trout in 1983. Following TFM treatment, the rate dropped to 2 in 100. With fewer lampreys killing fish, the increase in large 5-year-old lake trout exceeded even fishery managers' expectations. TFM still ranks as the most effective weapon in the war on sea lampreys.
We suspect that chemical treatments take care of 99% of the lamprey that are residing in the river system. But that's what we hope to do this year, is document that. And so far we have found very few of them, but no treatment is 100% effective. So around eddies, some of the backwater areas where the chemical couldn't reach, we find lamprey there.
So every 3 to 5 years, chemical crews return to reapply TFM to approximately 74 streams per season. But long before lamprocide ever enters a stream, crews spend many days conducting detailed population assessments. In places, that means sampling nearly 200 miles of stream, often with backpack electrofishing equipment, which stuns larvae buried in the mud and forces them to swim to the surface. Since the 1950s, surveys like these confirm the presence of larval sea lampreys in 480 of the 5,233 Great Lakes tributaries. And even though that amounts to only 9% of the streams, it still represents some of the region's most isolated wilderness. Just reaching some of these areas presents challenges and often demands special equipment. It has to be done, because assessment crews like Dale Olala's cannot take a chance and skip a year looking for lamprey.
One of the trips to this Ford River, West Branch, had not been infested for the last 15 years. We have now run into a population in there. What caused them to run up in there for the last several years is why we have to keep surveying these particular streams. If there's a real small population, it is not cost-benefit to treat a stream, so we probably wouldn't recommend it, but we only recommend areas that are infested with lamprey.
Once a stream is scheduled for treatment, more data need to be collected, particularly water chemistry measurements. pH, alkalinity, temperature, and oxygen concentration can influence the toxicity of TFM. And since rivers don't run a straight path, but snake through a complex maze of terrain, flow and water chemistry constantly change. So teams take measurements at a variety of locations.
We arrived here about 3 days ago and started our preliminary work of aging the stream to determine how much water is actually flowing down each tributary. We did some dye study work to try to time the speed of the river, so we know when and where to be with our chemical to apply it. We did a toxicity test or a bioassay, which tests the sea lamprey against the chemical in the water and a non-target species such as rainbow trout to try to determine how much chemical we can apply that will kill the lamprey and not hurt the fish in this river. We don't want to just put the chemical in at one time in one short lump, you might say. We spread it out, in this case, over a 14-hour period.
So that means we need a midnight shift.
Right.
Nets set downriver of application sites monitor the effects on stream life. Dead sea lampreys among live fish and insects proves a successful treatment.
But by tomorrow morning, we check these two nets, we'll probably get 2-quart jarfuls easily.
Mm.
By tomorrow morning, this lamprey is just starting to take effect on them now.
Something else moving there.
Analysis staff also keep close watch on TFM concentrations by taking water samples every half hour. If stream conditions change, so does the amount of chemical used. It's an important job and often means keeping watch all night long. TFM works, but it's not the total answer, particularly on large rivers like the St. Mary's, connecting Lake Superior and Huron. Cases like this require a variety of techniques.
The gradual cleanup of Algoma Steel and St. Mary's paper companies have caused considerable improvement in water quality in the St. Mary's. So this has also enabled sea lamprey to better survive in less contaminants, less pollutants. The habitat itself is improving gradually. We're looking at the entire outflow of Lake Superior here, anywhere from 75 to 95,000 cubic feet per second coming down from Lake Superior. To do a conventional TFM treatment is estimated to cost from $13 to $15 million just in lampricide alone, even if we could logistically do it with our lampricide.
Scientists continue to work on solutions for the St. Mary's and other trouble spots, such as the deep water pockets at river mouths where larvae settle.
What we're looking at now is some alternate control techniques which will supplement the use of pesticide, reduce reliance on it, and I think will provide effective treatment, hopefully, and be ecologically sound at the same time. Strike a balance.
One of those new techniques is underway at the Hammond Bay Biological Station on Lake Huron.
Sterilization is a technique that's been used on insects for many years. Back in the early 70s, some of our researchers at Hammond Bay thought there was some potential here, so they began looking at it for use on sea lamprey. We capture spawning run lampreys in portable assessment traps along many of the tributaries to the Great Lakes. We will select out the male lampreys and transport them to the sterilization facility at Hammond Bay. At the sterilization facility, we inject the lampreys with a chemosterilant. The chemosterilant is very active biologically, and we have to be careful not to expose the workers to the chemical or to release any to the environment. That's why we hold the lampreys for 48 hours after they're injected before returning them to the spawning streams. People ask me why we don't just cut the heads off the lampreys. Why are we putting them back in the stream? The point is, by sterilizing the male lampreys and releasing them into the stream, we have the opportunity to fool the female lampreys. They will waste their reproductive potential on the sterile male lampreys instead of the normal male lampreys, and we'll be able to reduce the number of eggs that actually hatch in that stream. Once lampreys spawn, they die. Since a lamprey generation can exceed 7 years, we won't see the benefit of this program for at least that long.
But predictions show that even a ratio of 2 sterile males to 1 fertile male could result in about a 65% reduction in sea lampreys.
Successful pest control programs try to use an integrated approach to pest management. That means attacking the animal from several of its vulnerable positions. With the addition of the sterilization program to our chemical control program and our barrier program, we've got a truly integrated pest control program for lampreys.
Barriers, whether natural or man-made, can be an effective management tool. The commission is reviewing a variety of designs to work on different streams. One experiment tests a velocity barrier.
Sea lamprey are poorer swimmers than most other fish, and their only great advantage is that they can attach to surfaces, to rocks, to logs. If you remove the advantage of attaching, then you can create velocity barriers and stop them from swimming upstreams. And so we're testing different materials. We're also testing their swimming performance, how far they can swim against different currents, different velocities of water.
McCauley's also testing how other fish, walleye, trout, and salmon, maneuver through the trough. Changing the flow of a river can have serious results. So in 1986, when the Brule River barrier was constructed in Wisconsin, engineers designed a sophisticated set of fish ladders that allow jumping fish to pass but keep lampreys out. A video camera, operated 24 hours a day by the Wisconsin DNR, records movements past the underwater window, so biologists keep an accurate measure of their success.
This barrier, although it cost a lot of money to initially build it and set it in place, has been up to this point 100% effective in stopping them from reproducing. What we're doing is taking away as much production area for sea lampreys as possible.
Even if the commission had the money to construct a barrier on every river, Pratt explains it still may not work everywhere.
This is a very famous trout and salmon stream, and the one thing that you have to be very careful in constructing any type of a dam with a pool just upstream of that dam is that that pool, the size of that pool, doesn't warm the water and make it non-trout water. This location was chosen because it has a very good understructure that we can pin the barrier to. It's a solid sandstone rock base. It's also at a location that's very steep, so that when we built the structure, the upstream pool above the barrier is very small. It only extends maybe 500 yards upstream, and then we move into the next rapids. That was real important also. The best case scenario would be build one at the lake, but that wasn't possible on the pool.
Managing an exotic pest is never easy, especially when it lives in a watershed covering 295,000 square miles, which includes the largest freshwater lake system in the world.
We just saw our nest right here before we came out.
Scientists have a tough time just estimating how many sea lampreys are produced, particularly in major rivers like the St. Mary's, where deep water and strong current make assessments difficult even for scuba divers and specially designed underwater cameras.
We're not out to kill the last sea lamprey. We realize that that's not possible. So we want to find a very cost-effective balance.
Just as it takes more than chemical treatments to stop lamprey, it takes more than sea lamprey control to produce a prospering fishery. This work is only one piece of the fishery management puzzle.
Fundamental concept is the concept of healthy aquatic ecosystems in the Great Lakes. Recognizing that the Great Lakes are indeed an ecosystem or a set of ecosystems, and that what one might do to one part of that system will have an impact throughout the system.
The goal is to keep momentum, balancing the current maintenance program while exploring new techniques to protect this multi-billion dollar resource. That exploration and development can occur only through research. At the Hammond Bay Biological Station, scientists sample blood from a wounded lake trout to monitor the sea lamprey's effects. They are also studying the sea lamprey's sensory system to find out what attracts or repels them, as well as what hormones trigger their transformation and reproduction. Finding these keys takes time, but the information could result in new methods for trapping, removing, and controlling sea lampreys. The management effort is expensive, but a sound investment. Estimates show every dollar spent on lamprey control enhances the Great Lakes economy through better fishing and increased recreation.
Why do we spend all the money to plant salmon and these beautiful harbors, motels, restaurants, everything else it depends on? We got to do something to stop it. It just kills the fishing.
Can I hold it up and show that boat?
Tourism industry throughout the Great Lakes
is what it is today and is built back in the last 10 to 15 years because of the fishing since the sea lamprey program has brought back the lake trout and allowed the salmon fishing to be what it is throughout the Great Lakes.
This success comes from decades of progress, but the battle with the relentless sea lamprey is not over. Some parts of the battle have already swung in the lamprey's favor. If we cannot keep pace through adequate control and development of new techniques, the successes of the past decades will deteriorate. The fishery, enjoyed by 5 million people, will be lost, as will both the public and private investments. Protecting the fishery and the Great Lakes ecosystem requires the cooperation of all who enjoy this marvelous resource. Together, we can preserve this treasure for future generations.
This video has been a product of the Great Lakes Fishery Commission, working in partnership with citizens and governments to provide healthy ecosystems and integrated management of sea lampreys and fish.
The Great Lakes, a fishing and recreational paradise. Nearly 20% of all fresh water on the surface of our planet is here. It is a magnet for millions of tourists, as well as commercial and recreational fishers who pour billions of dollars into the region's economy. But there is something lurking beneath the placid surface of these waters that threatens the fishing, the fun, the economy, the very future of this precious natural resource. There's a predator in paradise. This ancient predator is more than 300 million years old. Older than the dinosaurs. It entered the Great Lakes through man-made shipping canals in the early part of the 20th century. This invader is an aggressive parasitic marine animal with the scientific name Petromyzon marinus, but commonly called the sea lamprey. Sea lampreys are vampire-like killers that look like an alien creature from a late-night horror movie. Using a tooth-rimmed suction cup mouth, lampreys attach themselves to a fish, rip a hole through the victim's skin with their raspy tongue, and literally suck their prey's life out. In a span of less than 25 years, sea lampreys devastated the Great Lakes fishery. They feasted on prized large native fish, like lake trout, until by the late 1950s, when these prized species of native fish were on the brink of extinction. The story you are about to hear is about how science, hard work, and a little luck brought this aquatic menace under control. Although we have them under control for the moment, sea lampreys remain a clear and present danger to the ecology and economy of the Great Lakes Basin. These are tenacious, exotic predators who, unfortunately, found the Great Lakes to be a fantastic new home, attacking sport and commercial species and shaking the foundations of fishing communities. Without constant vigilance, the destruction of the Great Lakes fishery that occurred because of sea lampreys will be repeated, a tragedy which cannot be allowed to be repeated. Sea lampreys are a primitive, jawless creature. While they resemble the Native American eel, they are not related. They have gills, but lack the paired fins found on most fish. They are vertebrates, but their skeletal structure consists only of cartilage, not bones, just like a shark. Their tail is broad and flat like a paddle. They swim through the water with a snake-like motion. Lampreys can grow to 51 centimeters or 20 inches in length and weigh up to a third of a kilogram or 3/4 of a pound. Lampreys are unusual in that they start life with a larval stage that metamorphoses into the parasitic form that is so damaging. The sea lamprey's most remarkable feature, though, is only present once it enters the parasitic phase. It is a tooth-studded, suction cup-like oral disc used to secure the lamprey to its prey while feeding. Hundreds of sharp teeth on the rim of the oral disc provide a death grip. Once attached to their prey, these teeth make it very difficult for even the biggest of fish to dislodge the lamprey. Lampreys use a razor-sharp tongue to rasp a hole through their victim's skin and suck their blood and body fluids. The lamprey's saliva contains a special enzyme that stops the fish's blood from clotting. Being a top predator, they consume a wide variety of Great Lakes fish, while few things prey on them. Mature adult sea lampreys produce large numbers of eggs, which guarantees more parasitic adult feeders. Lastly, lampreys locate viable streams for spawning using a pheromone or odor excreted by native and non-native lamprey larvae. When detected by an adult, the pheromone signals that a stream contains both good spawning grounds and good habitat for larvae. To map out an effective strategy for controlling sea lampreys, scientists first had to understand their complex life cycle. In spring or early summer, adults leave the deep water of the Great Lakes and move into tributaries where they, in clean gravel with flowing water, excavate depressions and build nests. Lampreys use their sucker mouth and whole body to move large stones, some outweighing the lamprey by more than 2 times. With these stones, they build a horseshoe-shaped nest. The ancient Greeks observed this curious behavior and named these creatures petromyzen, or stone suckers. The lamprey's unique mouth is also used in its mating ritual. The male sucks onto the back of the female's head while the two vibrate together, releasing sperm and eggs. Adult sea lampreys die after mating. The female will lay between 25,000 and 100,000 eggs. In about 21 days, as many as 6,000 of the fertilized eggs will hatch. When hatched, the small worm-like young are blind, toothless, and harmless. These larvae are called amacetes. Amacetes drift downstream in search of slower currents and sand or silt bottoms to establish burrows. They will live in these burrows for the next 3 to 5 years. Amacetes have a mouth called an oral hood. To feed, they draw water into the burrow to filter microorganisms, algae, and organic matter out of the water. Once the filter-feeding amacetes have grown to about 12 centimeters or 5 inches, they undergo an amazing metamorphosis. They go through a transformation, developing eyes, while the harmless oral hood changes into the distinctive tooth-ringed sucker mouth. This begins the predatory phase that makes them a menace. The sea lamprey is now ready to enter the Great Lakes, where it will spend the next 12 to 20 months feeding on fish. Sea lampreys once inhabited only the open oceans. By 1835, they had moved into Lake Ontario through man-made canals. Their progress was halted by Niagara Falls. It would seem our sea lamprey problem would have ended right there. So how, then, did they make it past Niagara Falls, allowing them to infest the other 4 Great Lakes? Niagara Falls, a natural barrier to the invading sea lampreys, was bypassed by the construction of the Welland Canal. Beginning in 1913, the Welland Canal underwent a series of construction projects to widen and deepen it. For the sea lamprey, these modifications were enough to allow access to Lake Erie and the Upper Great Lakes. Sea lampreys were first seen in Lake Erie in 1921, Lakes Huron and Michigan by 1937, and Lake Superior by 1939. the invasion was complete. In its original ocean habitat, sea lampreys have been known to attack swordfish, bluefin tuna, even basking sharks. It is not hard to imagine what they can do to the smaller prey of the Great Lakes. It is estimated that between 40 and 60% of all lake trout that are attacked by sea lampreys die from loss of blood or lethal wounds. The lamprey's favorite prey? Lake trout, salmon, and whitefish. But sea lampreys can be indiscriminate hunters. Combined with over-harvest from commercial fishing, the ecological and economic impact of this all-too-efficient predator contributed to the collapse of the Great Lakes fishing industry in the 1940s and 50s. Before the invasion, the U.S. and Canada harvested an average of 7 million kilograms or 15 million pounds of lake trout per year on Lakes Huron and Superior alone. But by the 1960s, as sea lamprey populations exploded, lake trout harvest was down to just 136,000 kilograms or about 300,000 pounds. What followed were 20 years of record lows in fish populations. When lampreys were at their peak, 85% of all large Great Lakes fish exhibited sea lamprey wounds. The result amounted to an ecological and economic chain reaction crash. With fewer lake trout eating alewives, another invasive fish in the Great Lakes, the alewife population exploded and their massive annual die-offs fouled many Great Lakes beaches in the 50s and 60s. With the beaches fouled, the tourists stayed away. With no tourists, tourism-related jobs suffered. Shoreline communities became undesirable places to visit or live. The bottom line? Nearly 100,000 tourism-related jobs and a lucrative fishing industry were in trouble. Clearly, something had to be done to recover from the disaster. The Great Lakes are a shared resource. The impact of sea lamprey predation on the fishery was a Canadian and U.S. problem. In 1955, the Great Lakes Fishery Commission, or GLFC, was formed under a treaty between Canada and the United States with the purpose of restoring the fisheries. The GLFC carries out its programs in partnership with the Department of Fisheries and Oceans Canada, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the U.S. Geological Survey, the U.S. Department of State, and other partner agencies. The Commission's mandate? Finding a way to control sea lampreys. The first thing the GLFC tried was to deny sea lampreys access to their spawning grounds by the use of mechanical and electrical devices. These initial efforts were ultimately considered too hazardous or ineffective. Effective control depends on exploiting vulnerabilities in the sea lamprey's life cycle to prevent creation of the next generation. The commission believed that sea lampreys were most vulnerable as larvae living in stream bottoms. In the 1950s, more than 6,000 compounds were tested in search of one that was selectively toxic, that would kill lampreys while leaving the rest of the fish population unharmed. Researchers, in fact, found two. The first, in 1958, was 3-trifluoromethyl-4-nitrophenol, often simply referred to as TFM. A second compound, dichloro-4-nitrosalicylanilide, was found in 1964 to make TFM even more effective when added in small amounts. It is commonly known as Balicide. Used in combination, TFM and Balicide provide an effective treatment program to control lampreys. Before treatments can begin, assessment teams survey the streams and tributaries. Using electrofishing equipment, biologists and technicians shock larvae out of their burrows to determine the magnitude of sea lamprey infestation. After the assessments are complete and prior to treatment, parameters such as stream discharge and water chemistry are measured to determine the proper concentration of lampricide to kill sea lampreys. After application is complete, lampricides rapidly degrade. The TFM treatment program is a massive undertaking. There are nearly 5,800 streams and tributaries on the Great Lakes. More than 400 of them are known to produce sea lampreys, and several hundred are treated on a regular cycle every 3 to 5 years. All are examined on a periodic basis for the presence of sea lamprey larvae. Lampricides are not the only weapon in the sea lamprey control arsenal. The GLFC and its partners also exploit the lamprey as they return to streams to spawn. Barriers, natural and man-made, deny sea lampreys access to their spawning grounds above the barrier. These inaccessible areas are safe and don't need to be treated with lampricides. Since sea lampreys are poor swimmers and can't jump, a low head barrier is an extremely effective tool in preventing access to spawning areas upstream. Most jumping fish have no trouble navigating low head barriers. Many other fish are passed manually. The Great Lakes Fishery Commission and its partners have constructed about 70 barriers throughout the Great Lakes Basin. Hundreds of other barriers built privately for industry, flood control, recreation, and other reasons provide additional protection from these invaders. New technologies like this inflatable barrier and stop log barriers are adjustable depending on the time of year or stream condition. During the spawning run, they are raised to stop sea lampreys from moving upstream to reproduce and lowered at other times to allow the streams to flow naturally. The Commission and its partners operate a network of sea lamprey traps throughout the Great Lakes Basin to control sea lamprey and measure the effectiveness of the control effort. The trapped female lampreys are discarded before they've had a chance to spawn. The male lampreys are used in an innovative control method called the sterile male release technique. Trapped male lampreys are taken to the world's only sea lamprey sterilization facility located in Hammond Bay, Michigan. The sterilized males are released in the St. Mary's River, the connecting channel between Lake Superior and Huron, which is too large to treat with TFM. You might logically ask, if the lampreys are captured, why don't we just kill them instead of putting them into the river? By sterilizing male lampreys and releasing them, we have the opportunity to fool the female lampreys into wasting their reproductive potential on the sterilized male lampreys instead of the normal, fertile male lampreys. By this point in the life cycle, sea lampreys no longer feed. Their digestive systems have shut down, so sterilized lampreys can be released without fear that they'll kill more fish. It is estimated that the ratio of 4 sterile males to 1 fertile male, combined with removal of females by traps, could result in as much as an 85% reduction in sea lampreys on the St. Mary's River. To complement sterilization and trapping, Balicide is applied precisely to lamprey hotspots on the river. Combined with Balicide treatments, trapping and sterilization have reduced sea lamprey populations in Lake Huron and northern Lake Michigan, protecting the valuable fisheries there. New cutting-edge technologies for sea lamprey control are being used, and others are on the horizon. For example, remember those pheromones? Scientists are studying how these chemical road markers can be used to lure sea lampreys into traps.
We were successful in identifying one component of the sea lamprey mating pheromone, and we're able to synthesize it and then test it in many streams and just put it into sea lamprey traps to see if we can catch more sea lampreys. We're testing it right now in 20 streams that historically have trapped sea lampreys, and indications are that we're catching more lampreys and the overall trap efficiencies are increased.
Other cutting-edge research uses genomic information to find ways to disrupt the sea lamprey life cycle or exploit other weaknesses. Scientists hope, for example, to understand what causes sea lamprey larvae to transform into a killer. Native Great Lakes lampreys have a life cycle similar to sea lampreys, but are small and they co-evolved with other Great Lakes fishes. In stark contrast, the non-native sea lampreys are much larger than native lampreys, and having few predators in the Great Lakes are strikingly lethal to Great Lakes fish. Managing sea lampreys is no easy task. They live in a 475,000 square kilometer or 295,000 square mile watershed, the largest freshwater lake system in the world. Scientists know that it would be impossible to kill every sea lamprey within our five Great Lakes and thousands of rivers and streams. However, the Sea Lamprey Program, with its goal to drastically reduce sea lamprey populations, is a huge success.
What we have here is a screw trap, and this is one of the tools we use in assessment. In this case, we're assessing the juvenile lamprey as they are out migrating, on their way out to the lakes to start feeding. And so we're going to try and intercept as many as we can. We also use this tool to evaluate how well of a job we did at estimating their population numbers.
Sea lamprey populations have been slashed by an astounding 90% in many areas of the Great Lakes. The goal of the GLFC is to keep the momentum moving. Today, the sea lamprey population is under control. But more than 50 years of successful sea lamprey management has demonstrated the need for continued action and vigilance to reduce lamprey populations throughout the Great Lakes Basin. Given even a small chance, this aquatic vampire has proven it can easily come back. A sea lamprey resurgence to former levels is not an option. This management effort is a sound investment. The Great Lakes fishery is worth more than $7 billion annually to the people of Canada and the United States. The money spent on sea lamprey control is returned to the Great Lakes economy through better commercial fishing and improved recreation and tourism. The environment is healthier and the ecosystem is returning to a more natural balance. Sea lampreys are under control, for now, but the predator is still among us.